it on the spot, bro.
Yeah.
Damn. And you're listening to, I can't say it, Clorazepate. Is that it?
Yes, sir.
By Color Science. It's like a radio show now. You guys are listening to episode 58 of the podcast. Boom. You are here, podcast. We got Karl Fernandez in the building. Let me get away with the housework. Find a podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube with a video, anchor.fm, anywhere you can find a podcast, www.youarehearpodcast.co. You cannot afford the M. And I'm Mike. I'm here. I'm happy. I'm here with Karl. Karl Fernandez. We're doing a little guest host. Dave is not in the studio today.
Dave is not here.
We got
I am taking his place.
How are you feeling, Karl?
Good, man. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, man. Thanks for coming to step in for Dave.
Yeah.
Originally, I was going to do like a recap because I was kind of tired.
Yeah.
But we mentioned doing a little guest hosting, and we've done it before. But I feel like now, and don't mind the fucking band going in. I don't know if you can hear that.
If you can hear that at home, enjoy it. It's pretty good.
They're going
it sounds
in.
Pretty good.
But yeah, I thought I'd bring you in and just, I don't know, get into some other things.
Yeah, man.
Besides the film stuff. We can still go into a little bit about I'll Meet You There and everything.
Yeah.
But I wanted to mention some stuff about, if you were listening in the beginning, the opening song, that was by Karl.
Yes, Color
Karl
Science is my music project.
Yes, Color Science. Link in the description. Check it out, guys. Actually, I'm very impressed by what you actually do with music and stuff.
Oh.
And I wanted to kind of get into that, how you got into making music and stuff like that.
Sure, yeah, absolutely. So, you're a musician too.
I don't like to call myself that, but I'm gonna say I make
you
music
the beats. You do
for
the
fun.
Beats
for fun.
Yeah.
For fun.
I see you on the Instagram.
Thanks,
yeah.
Dude.
Yeah. No, I. It was funny because I actually started doing music way before I did film or TV.
Really?
Yes, I did music. I started playing the guitar in sixth grade.
Oh man.
Yeah. I remember I was over. I had a lot of friends who were like skaters and stuff.
Yeah.
We all wore the Etnies and the Element and like you know. And so we loved Blink-182 and like Green Day and those bands. So like I wanted to start playing guitar, and my buddy, he had a the Squire Tom DeLonge Strat, the one like the Fender knockoff of
Blink-182's
guitars.
I'm not that good with like the names.
Oh, it's all good. Yeah.
Growing up, my dad played it. He played music for like all his life. And he still plays music, guitar, like hardcore, like heavy metal in Poland, European, like
is that
in a
him
band.
Right down the hall.
I don't know. It's definitely not him. Sounds like it. But like I was in my family, like music has always been a big thing. But I don't know why, like I picked up a bass and I tried to learn from him. And I was like, I can't do this. I don't want to do this shit. I want to play like some video games and waste my life away.
Yeah.
Which I wish I picked up something, man. Because now I'm like, oh, I'm going to do it. But now I have like zero time.
Yeah,
and like doing it an hour a day, like, well, when I get home at like 10 o'clock, I'm like, oh, yeah, let's just practice for it.
Right.
Not going to do it.
Yeah. You know? I haven't picked up a guitar in actually like a while. I actually I have a Les Paul, but like it's kind of like run down at the moment. I
gotta
get it set up and stuff. I might sell it actually, to be honest with you. But no, I miss playing. And I, you know, I picked that up in sixth grade. And then my brother picked up the bass. So we would like just cover Blink songs and stuff. For, like,
oh,
you know?
Wow.
Yeah. So we did that like, that was like from sixth grade to like eighth grade. And then, in high school, I kind of did more of the music stuff on my own, but I didn't really start recording until like my sophomore year.
Word.
And I had a really shitty the USB like Logitech just like stick mic thing.
Oh my god!
And I recorded like my acoustic on there and my vocals and Audacity, if you know Audacity.
Yeah.
All the home engineers know Audacity.
Know,
you
yeah.
know what that is, yeah. And
that's that struggle.
Yeah, that's no plugins. And I didn't know anything. I was just
got some effects.
Yeah, I didn't know how to
distort.
Gain stage. Yeah,
just
everything.
Distort everything.
Yeah, I did chorus on just like everything that I can do just to make it sound spacey and wide and stuff, but. Yeah, I did that, and then I played in a couple bands.
Lord.
And
did you and your brother ever do a band?
Interestingly enough, not really. I don't know why. He's a great musician.
Really,
Staten is his name.
Staten.
Yeah, you can. He's amazing.
Plug him in there too.
Yeah, amazing. And he's working on an album right now. Actually, I was leaving the house and he was working on it.
Yes.
So he does a lot of music. He releases a lot more than I do. I've done one album so far, but. So he has been doing his own thing, and then I was in a couple bands in high school, and. Yeah, and then after that, I kind of got into the film TV thing like my senior year of high school.
Mm.
So throughout most of high school, I was still doing music.
Yeah.
So, yeah, people are surprised. People are like, wow, I thought you just picked up like doing music. No, I've been doing music for
That's
a really long
like.
Time. No, I've been doing it for
Damn.
Quite some time
All
now.
Right,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
I wanted to kind of get into this too with music and film and like technology and shit. Mm-hmm. I feel like there's so many good movies or so many good artist, like music, like, and anyone can record now. It's so easily accessible.
Yeah.
It's kind of saturated.
Yeah.
Like, how do you feel about, I was thinking about, cause I always want to, I tell myself every year, I'm like, I got to put out something, like at least a single. Like, I've always been working up to like albums and stuff like that.
That's been me the last 3 years.
I know. And like, it's just so hard to be like, should I just put something out just so I can get something? Cause that was my big thing with film and like also like I like YouTube and like making videos. Like,
sure.
I've been doing that, like kind of like how you've been doing music.
Yeah.
I've always been like making like YouTube videos. Cause that's like a whole different like kind of thing you can do now.
Right.
And like sustain off it.
Yeah.
But, just like deciding what to do in this fucking like pool.
Yeah.
Of just so much shit is like so hard to,
exactly.
So how do you feel like putting out an album with everything? Like, do you think it's hard for people to like listen, to like a full project like that? Because I feel like projects have been getting shorter and shorter.
Kind of, yeah.
But I feel like with maybe we might be going back to maybe more long form listening, because like the vinyl resurgence, I guess, kind of like adds to that maybe a little bit.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, you're right though. I mean, and we did kind of touch on this the last time I was here with Jordan,
a couple
episodes back, where we talked about filmmaking and how it's so accessible and there's no excuse, you know. And then the same thing with the music, you know, you can get great quality mics for like $100 now, you know. That wasn't the case like 20, 30 years ago. And the software too, there's a lot of great free software now, not just Audacity.
And even to use it, it's like you can learn everything.
Yeah, again, in YouTube, you can kind of find out tutorials and, you know, beats and stuff. You have like Fruity Loops or, you know, Ableton or one of those pieces of software. But I feel like, it's funny, when I did my album, it wasn't supposed to be an album.
Really?
I think the total product is 12 songs.
Yes.
It's like 45 minutes of material. I was only supposed to do an EP. I was only going to do like four songs. That's kind of like what I wanted to do with the project. Just do short little 3 to 4 song little releases.
Mm-hmm.
So that way I don't get bored and people don't get bored. Yes. You know what I mean? Because it's hard, man. It's like a lot of rappers these days, they release 24 track albums and like, you can't sit through the whole thing, man. It gets rough. Like,
I remember the last thing, I think the last person that did that, I think, was like Drake with Scorpion.
Yeah.
And I feel like that was like, usually like,
especially not even his best album. Sorry, guys.
Yeah. And like Drake was like, honestly, like right now you can say he's like the number one stream kind of like rapper. Because he like kind of ventures off into like all different genres, like pop and,
sure.
and like kind of the mainstream kind of thing.
Right.
But with that album, like I feel like that barely got any recognition at all.
Yeah, I don't know. It kind of
came, and it was kind of strange, like the way it was kind of split in half.
Yeah, not the strongest project.
Yeah.
I didn't give it a lot of listens, but I gave it enough to realize, hey, you know what? Not really. I'm gonna go back to views. You know what I mean? Or I'm gonna go back to if you're reading this. You know, like but yeah, the long. I don't know. I feel like if you're gonna do something like that, like anything longer than 12 songs, it has to be more of like a concept album where there's like a story, you know what I mean?
Yes.
And like you got to lead them in
Word.
And do that. So I kind of did that with this album. A lot of the songs on this album that I wrote, and I released it in July, it's all on Spotify and stuff. A lot of those songs were written like in different periods of my life.
Really?
Yeah. The first couple songs are actually the most recent. I wrote that like fall of 2017.
Cool.
I released the album in 2019, but I did the music video for January of 2018.
Yes.
Jordan shot it and Shireen was on it and stuff. But yeah, it took me a while to actually compile an album and compile all the songs, because a lot of those songs, so those were the recent ones, and there are songs that I wrote back in like 2014, 2015. And I remember just finding the stems, like it's all buried in my hard drive. You know what I mean? Like these are songs that have just been like percolating and boiling, you know what I mean? And I find them and I'm like, can I remix this? Like, can I like actually, like now that I know what I'm doing, more experience with mixing and EQing and compressing and stuff like that. Found those project files and lo and behold, I was able to like kind of save them.
Hell yeah.
And I ended up releasing them. So a lot of those songs are really old songs that I probably wouldn't write like that anymore, but like, it's fun to just sort of like put that out there just to see. Like,
it's kind of interesting. I mean, I listened to it like this week. Just because leading up to this, I kind of wanted to like, I don't know, refresh.
Sure.
And a couple songs, like I play them at the cafe I go.
Oh no!
I work out.
Man.
I play them. So just want to say I'm kind of repping while I'm there and I'm working. But it's like a very cohesive sound, and I feel like it's so interesting to hear like you like with music how similar it is to kind of like the filmmaking aspect.
Because
I feel like, I don't know, there's certain like just like aesthetics in the music that kind of fits with like the way you shoot things or how long you like. I feel like one thing like is powerful in your like shooting and everything and just like editing and stuff together is like you let the moment kind of ride. And yeah. I feel like that with the music too. Like an atmosphere is kind of built. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I feel like that's cool that I can like get that from both, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny because like, and when I started the project, you know, color science, for anyone who doesn't know, it's actually a camera term. It's meant to describe the way the sensor in the camera reads color. Yep. And so it's a term that you hear a lot. Mm. And you know, I'm a director, DP and stuff. So I wanted to sort of combine the two things, like, you know, take the music, but kind of add like my filmmaking flair to it. So just naming the project that alone. And then I kind of had to figure out what I wanted it to sound like.
Yeah.
Because again, I listened to a lot of like, you know, pop punk and a lot of like those like alternative rock bands growing up. But now I listen to a lot of trap. I listen to a lot of modern pop, and I've expanded a lot. And so it was in electronica too. So it's like, mm-hmm. I wanted to see if I can combine all that kind of stuff. It's also hard to do like a full band type thing when I'm just me.
Yeah.
A lot of people do it, but like I can't play the drums. Tough. I can't play the drums for shit.
You ever try?
Yes.
Oh man, it's so bad.
I suck, dude. It's so bad. I have a lot of friends who are drummers and like they're decent.
I don't know why I just can't get, I feel like you just got to practice every day.
Yeah.
Just sitting there and doing like, I just try to keep
like
a rhythm.
The foot thing's
my problem.
Yeah.
That's the biggest problem.
I always hit the kick when I don't mean to and I can't keep the right arm hitting the hi-hat and then the snare. Stupid, like, you got snare like, control with the left hand. I can't do it. It's just too much for me. You know, guitar, bass I can do and I can sing, but like even that's a stretch. But like I can like, you know, I can keep rhythm and tempo and stuff like that. I just can't do the percussive. Like,
yeah,
that rhythm. It's too much pressure, man.
Too much pressure.
There's a lot of toms, high toms, mid toms, a lot of things to that kit, man. I don't know. So I find doing the electronic part of it is like a lot.
Yes.
Like, you know, you do the same thing. You make beats and stuff. Yeah. And I think that's
sampling
the one thing.
Sampling shit. It's like, I can use anything.
Exactly. You know? And you can do it by yourself and make it sound really good. So, you know. I tended to lean on that, but I still wanted to incorporate the poppy elements and then a little bit of the trap influence. So kind of got that meshed all together.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
What's like the music you kind of like, what's the last thing you listened to?
Well, on the way up here, I was listening to Lil Baby's new album.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's all right. It's I like Lil Baby, but like, in doses. And he, again, that album's 24 tracks. And it's
really?
Yeah, dude. It's a long album. I'm just like, a lot of filler stuff. Uh-huh. Don't hate me, Lil Baby. If I ever get a chance to meet you, I'd love to. But I'm just saying a lot of his other stuff is like, you know, easier to just run through it. This one's a little bit more of like, all right, I got to turn it off for a little bit, you know.
I mean... When you like say that, and like sometimes when I think about it, going back to like your favorite albums, and like let's say they're made like more back in the day, this goes with like classic albums too, like Sgt. Pepper's or some shit. It's not every track is great,
right?
You know what I mean?
I think
when you think about it, maybe it's like better to have these shorter albums, so like every track is kind of worth it. And if someone hears something that's like 5-7 tracks and like every track is amazing, you're like, oh, this album's amazing.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, but if you hear something that's a tough like line, I guess.
Yeah, because it's weird, because when you know, you're an artist and you want to create, you're going to keep creating.
Yeah.
And, you know, like people, you know, and I guarantee you a lot of these artists I know, I forgot who it was, but you know, most of these artists now, they've probably recorded thousands of songs. They have like it in like a safe in a vault somewhere, and they're just hand selecting tracks to make an album to appease like their record deal or whatever. But no, these people are actually in the studio like all the time and they're just pumping out, you know, content or whatever. And it's just them trying to figure a way to like, you know, but I do think shorter is a better way to go. I am working on a new like demo EP right now. It's almost done actually. But I'm leaving that at like 6 tracks the most.
Nice.
I might even cut it down to 4 or 5, you know, because I just want it to be quick, easy. No more than like 20 minutes. Yeah. It's like on a nice drive from like point A to point B, you can just do it really fast. You know what I mean? Do you know Tierra Whack?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know when she did that album? It's like 15 songs, but they're all 1 minute long.
Oh, really?
All the tracks are one. And like, I think.
Was that her last album or was it before that?
I don't know. I haven't kept up with her recently, but yeah, I think it was last year. It came out sometime last year. But yeah, it was like 15 songs, but they're all 1 minute long. And that's they're crazy. All really good. You know what I mean? Like, and you can just
that
digest
it. That kind of pisses me off though.
Kind of, but I think it shows some restraint in it's like, how do you make a song? Like, you got to build the song up. You can't just like jump into it.
Yeah,
you got to find a way to build into it, and then you got to do the song, and you got to end it, and to do that in like a minute, 15
that's
times
true.
And they all sound different. They're all not like the same, you know. They're all different style. Like, you can hear it, like it's
really
audibly different.
I was gonna say, I was like I want people to make more, because now tracks that come out, especially like a lot of like trap bangers and stuff, they're all like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Like 220.
Yeah.
Two to three minutes
is like the.
And like sometimes it's like, man, it's so short. But actually trying to make a track like that's more than 3 minutes, it's so hard, man.
Yeah. I tend to, I either go like really short, I either do like a minute and a half to 2 minutes, or I do like 4.5 minutes. Mm. Like I can't, like 3 minutes, yeah, but like it's hard to find, to nail that in between.
Yeah, man.
Because, I don't know, there's structure, you know? Like, yeah. A lot, you know, if you do pop music, you know the structure. It's the intro, verse, pre-chorus, chorus, intro again, into the second verse, maybe you do a break in between, and then you do the chorus again, then a bridge, maybe. I don't like bridges too much. If you ever listen to my music, I actually only really do two verses and then chorus.
Yeah.
I don't really do bridges that often, mainly because I'm lazy. It's hard.
Like most people don't want to do that shit either.
Well, no, I just, I don't know. I feel, as a songwriter, it's funny because it's like, I feel by the time I get to the end of the second verse, like that's all I have to say.
Yeah.
So I'll just do the chorus again and maybe switch up the chorus a bit. Yeah, but then I'm like, how am I supposed to drag this into like a bridge? And then like, you know, and maybe you could do instrumentals and rely more on like the musicianship, I guess, you know, but.
I wanted to ask like another thing with making, because you're singing too and doing like all the instrumental stuff.
Sure.
Like finding like a voice, I feel like you found like a pocket, like a voice that you have for your music and it like matches and meshes well.
Yeah.
Like how did you go about like find that? Did you have like different versions of like that kind of thing? Because right now I think my hardest thing is like finding like a voice.
Yeah.
Because I want to do like some singing, rapping kind of things.
Right. Yeah.
But like to actually do that is like tough.
Yeah. No, I mean it definitely is. It takes a while. Like I've been recording and like writing songs like I guess in my adult life, like not counting little like Logitech mic demos, actual recording and stuff. I've been doing that since like 2013. I just put out my first album last year, 2019.
Yeah.
See how long it took me to release like these songs? I mean, I can blame that on me just either A, being lazy, or B, not being satisfied with myself to the point where I didn't think it was good enough to release.
Uh-huh.
So those, factors, but I think, you're right. Finding like that style, like just the way you can mesh your music and your vocals and your style of writing too is a big thing. I don't know. It's hard. It is hard. It's not easy. You just gotta keep. You just again. Like I have like hundreds of songs that like will probably never see the light of day. Yeah. Never see the light of day. But I keep them around because maybe there's a hook or maybe a line that I really liked and I want to emulate that and recreate that for another thing.
Yeah, I see that for sure.
Yeah. So like I do that a lot where I'll just go like reference tracks. I'll go back to my own work back then. Mm. Maybe it's something I like. Maybe I'll listen to it again and be like, this is shit. No wonder I didn't release it. You know what I mean? So trial and error. It's just like record a bunch of things and see what sticks and then show some of your friends. And if they like it, then, you know, it's cool.
Yeah.
And then,
the extent of like the stuff I make is I just like I mainly do instrumental. I haven't like laid any vocals down for anything yet. I just write and I'm like, I'm never going to record this because I'm too scared. And like I feel like it's going to be terrible. But I've been trying to like to push myself to like actually do it.
You should, man.
Yeah. Just to like put something down. But because like, honestly, dude, I got some bars.
You got bars, dude.
Gotta
lay them down, man. Lay them down, bro.
And I just want to keep them forever.
Yeah.
But I always go back to like, whenever I make music, I always sit there. I'm like, I get like this idea, or I hear a sample, and I'm like, oh, I want to do this. I want to do this sound. I'll try this sound. Like I hear something here, and I put down like a loop. It's a 10-second loop.
Yeah.
And usually it starts there, and like the first, like I've gotten to points where I'm like, I got a full track, and I'm like, fuck, like, and like the amount of times I go back just to like reference and just be like, oh, like this is cool. Like, I wish I could like keep this. And some of it's like stuff from, like I started making stuff maybe like, this was like when I had like, I gauged my time on which computer I was on.
That's actually my thing too.
Right?
Yeah.
Like I had like my laptop now. It's like my good, like, I paid 2 G's, I'm good. I have a laptop from before. It was like 400. I got it for like school and it's like the worst thing in the world. And like every sound was delayed on key press and shit. It's the worst thing. But I have some tracks on there. I'm like, I love that.
Exactly,
and then I have like my main first computer and like, it's like stored in my closet in like the corner. Like, I'm like, one day I'm going to bring it
one
up.
One day.
And I'm going to look at all those files.
Yeah.
But I think like that cross referencing like from back to old stuff is cool.
Yeah, it's always good to, you know, and then you can see how you wrote back then to how you write now. And maybe you can find a happy medium and put the
essentially
two
it's the same for what's happening with the film thing too, no?
Yeah, absolutely. You look at old projects that you shot and, you know, like there's a certain style and aesthetic that you know, catches your eye and you want to replicate that, but you also want to improve or do something more with it.
Mm.
And it's the same thing with music, trying to progress but also kind of keep in your signature sound or like whoever it is you are, you know. You want to keep always keep you in it, you know what I mean? Don't ever take you out of it. But I think that's important. And it isn't, you know, some people get it like super quick, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, Billie Eilish, like, look at her. Yeah. I mean, come on.
Oh, that's crazy. That's,
you know what I mean? Like, the amount of time that I spent on my music compared to, you know, her, I mean,
within a year, like, just blew up.
Yeah, out of nowhere. And now she's got multiple Grammys, you know what I mean? And then there are people who've been nominated like 15 times and haven't won once, you know what I mean? And so I feel like, I don't know, it's just,
that's gotta hurt, man.
Yeah.
That's gotta hurt a lot.
Yeah. I mean, that's how it is, though, isn't it? Yeah. Like, you kind of just, how many people are there in the world? How many people consider themselves artists and creators? You know, some people are just going to excel faster at a faster pace than others, which is, you know, don't take that as a negative.
Yeah.
Use it as a positive, you know, let it motivate you to want to get to that point. But, you know, I don't know but here's the thing. It's funny because everyone, you know, all my friends and Jordan and everyone, they're just like, when are you going to start doing shows? When are you going to start playing shows? I have no intention. I don't want to play shows.
Really?
Yeah. I've done the performing thing in high school. I've done the frontman thing and like, it's cool and all, but like, I don't it's tough to be. Yeah. It's tough. It's fun though. When like, you know, when you're at the right crowd and stuff. But I don't know. Now I feel like, you know, I like being behind the scenes, you know what I mean? Yeah, I'd rather be working the mixing board. You know, I'd rather be touching the knobs on that thing than like actually be on stage at this point in my life. So
maybe that could be like would you be down to do like a, instead of like you just being there performing, if you do like a kind of like experience kind of thing instead? I don't know, like a show, some sort of like live show.
So like an art show, like something more generalized. Yeah, I mean, like
that'd be cool.
I wouldn't rule out the possibility of doing something live. Like, you know, everyone's trying to get me to do like open mics and stuff, and like, that's cool. Like, I think I could do that. Like, that's it. You know, little living room shows or whatever.
Dude,
that's
fine. All right, I work at a cafe, and we got open mics. And dude, throw no shade, but I don't want to be the guy that's 50 doing open mics.
There you go. That's the thing.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because you see that, and you come for $20 a week, and it's like,
all right, you get a free latte, and then you're $20, and then you know, but you know,
and your friends are coming to support. It's like, dude.
Yeah. I will say this. I would rather do like an open mic or like play in public or whatever.
It's good practice
without like anyone paying attention to me. I'd love to just do
background. On the street?
Yeah, that or like, you know, you ever go to like banquet halls when they do brunch? Have you ever been to like a brunch spot and they have like someone doing the guitar or doing piano, but
piano
like
in the back,
no one gives a fuck about them. They're eating Eggs Benedict. They don't give a shit about like the music that you're playing.
Mimosas going
bottomless mimosas. Like they don't care, but they clap for you when you're done. You know what I mean? The worst is when they don't.
That's why working at the cafe is the worst.
Yeah.
Because I'm there and I'm like, I have to be here. I can't just look away and be like, all right. Because the guy's going to look at me and come up and ask for a drink. And I'm going to be like, here you go.
Yeah.
And then look down.
Yeah.
That's why every time I just clap.
Yeah,
if there's no claps, I'm like, ah, fuck it.
Exactly. I tend to clap the loudest. Like,
and when I clap, like I notice I start the claps.
Yeah.
Because people don't want to sometimes.
Exactly.
They feel weird.
It's a bystander effect. Yeah, you know, no one wants to do anything until they see someone else.
I'll give everyone a clap. You come to the Fine Grind in Little Falls. I'm doxing my location.
I was gonna say
open mics. You can just come and if you want to do open mic, I'll clap for you.
There you go.
I'll clap for you.
I might show up and I might clap.
I might die, dude. That's actually a bad idea. Whatever, dude.
It's all good.
Yeah. I wanted to get into a little bit on the film, the status.
Okay.
What's going on? How's it going?
Oh my god.
How you feeling?
It's like I'm getting this question every week. I feel great.
I wanted to go into that with like how you feel being like, because I feel like a lot of the. All right, you do a film and you shoot everything and like everyone's like, oh shit. It's like a happy moment when you guys are done. You're like, yes.
You know,
and everyone's like at their happiest moment all together and you're like, oh, I love you guys.
But
then like a week later, I was like, where the fuck is,
where's
how's everything? Anyone in post-production gets this. It's like, people are like, where the fuck is everything?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's like the amount of time it actually takes.
Yeah.
Pre-production actually doing is actually a very short amount of time sometimes, but it could be long depending on what you are.
It was long for us.
Yes, it was definitely long. But the post is like, that's tough, man.
Yeah.
It's like so many things come to it.
Yeah.
Music, audio, editing, sound, picture, everything.
Exactly. Like. And especially if it's not a full blown production company, like, you know, where there's one person for each stage of the way, so they get their own share of the work. I'm the one who's like, you know, I put this on myself, you know, but like, you know, so I can't complain. I'm not complaining, but like, it is one of those things where it's like, if you're doing all that, cause I'm like, I literally import all the footage and I'm like syncing all the audio and I'm cutting it and I'm going back, I'm watching all the takes and then, you know, writing notes for the audio. And then like, I'm cleaning up the audio. I'm, I scored like a track in the thing. I had my brother scoring the rest and like, you know, doing all that and trying to get a rough cut and then trying to cut down and like, you know, as a director trying to figure out what's the best way to tell the story and stuff. Like, you know, most of the Hollywood movies or even like higher end indie movies, you know, there's always a separate editor. Yeah. You know what I mean? The director almost rarely ever edits, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
You have some directors who shoot their own stuff, but mm-hmm. like normally there's always a separate editor.
Mm-hmm.
And that takes a whole load off. So when you're doing all of that, like I was for this.
I guess sometimes though, in like, especially like bigger films back in the day, I feel like directors usually go with the editor and like stand in with
them.
Oh
yeah, yeah,
right?
Yeah. They absolutely
do. So maybe
do
it
that.
Makes sense that like you do
absolutely,
both sometimes.
Yeah, exactly. Like then, you know, the director, yeah, but like as far as like actually putting it together,
the editor
will be there for maybe, they'll sit in for like a couple sessions or whatever, but then like a lot of the time the editor.
It's definitely ideal to have both.
Yeah.
Because like I feel like as just the editor, you're taking both and that's like so taxing.
It's taxing. And then the worst part is when I can't see my own mistakes because it's like I've seen the same thing so many times. I just don't know.
Yeah.
When I showed the rough cut to everyone like so far in the crew, you know, everyone was like, great, great. There's a couple notes and like things that I completely overlooked or like didn't even think about. And then like they get brought up to me by Dave or Jordan or anyone else, my brother. And then I don't look at things for a while. I don't, you know, I try and step back. Which is probably why it's taken this long because I'll take a break and then it ends up like I get caught up with doing some other stuff and then it ends up being like a week before, you know. But I do think it is very important to take a couple days off after you grind and once you get the whole like cut together, just don't look at it for like a week.
Yeah, that's I think that's one thing that was so tough in like college and shit, like going for film. It's tough because it's such a short time period. You just have this class and like, I know for my thesis and like I was doing like a web series and stuff, you have deadlines and like to have a deadline and be like, you can't like do something, sit there and like go for like a week and like send it to other people and be like, look at this, let me know notes and everything. And just being there, that first cut to you can seem so like amazing.
Yeah.
And like, oh, this is it. Like, and you don't want to say anything else.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know, like just learning that.
Yeah. And then a week later,
the hard way.
Yeah. The week later you watch it. You're like, what the fuck was I thinking? Like, why did I cut the shot that short? Yeah. Or like, why did I not use this take?
Yeah.
Even now, last time we were here, when Jordan was here, like two episodes ago, I went over to his place immediately after, and we started working on the color grade. And we were still changing some shots, like we're pick locked, but like we were still adding a few like things that I didn't even see. Like I just didn't even. Jordan's like, you didn't look through all the footage. You're right, I didn't, because I was doing other things. I was getting what was necessary for the story, which is good, but I should have been more due diligent and combing over every single piece of footage, and that's hard when you don't have an editor or an assistant editor, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, but you know, yeah, so we made those cuts, and even Jordan, when he made the, he gave me the first pass of the color grade and it was great. I thought it looked great, but there were definitely areas that caught my eye. I'm like, this needs to be corrected. This needs to be corrected. And then I think he took a couple days off from working on it. And then that's when I came over his house and I ended up like sitting with him, and the next pass he gave me the day after looks so much better. Like everything just matched a lot better. And and he was like, man, I needed those couple days to like not see that. So that way I could sort of see the mistakes again. So I will say this, the next thing I do, next like major project that gets funded or whatever, I'm not editing. I'm either going to write and direct or like, that's it. Like, I don't want to like.
It felt really good for me, at least, going from in college doing like my thesis and like taking on more role and like stuff previously, like taking on a lot of roles that I really shouldn't be taking on and just focusing on one, doing this and just doing the audio and being like, I'm just going to record and that's it.
Yeah.
You know, it felt good to like just be like a role
instead of
the head of something.
Exactly. Cause you can concentrate on what you have to do.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more pressure because if something happens and it's like completely on me, cause you don't have an excuse.
Like, sitting there like, oh fuck.
Yeah. No, I mean, luckily none of that happened, but it's funny because we did talk about the last time we talked about tips for like new filmmakers or whatever, and we said don't like let go and do everything, you know, like let people do their thing. That's true, but I also kind of thought about it a couple days later. I do think it's good to try and at least do one project where you try to do everything, because I think, at least for me as a director, doing someone else's job makes you empathetic towards them.
Yes.
So it's hard for you to run like the whole show, but you don't know what people need or how they have to get their job done. if you've done it before, then you at least know.
Yes.
Like with you, it's like, you know, like sound in general, it's like, okay, I need time to set the mixer up and like, you know, fan power and all this other stuff. Like me, if I was a director, which didn't know any of that, I'd be like, you'll get the sound up now. Like we need, you know, but like, if you need a couple minutes, like I understand why.
Yeah.
Same thing with the lighting and stuff. Like I understand, like, you know, I'm not a good grip or I'm not a great gaffer, but like I understand the amount of time it takes to do that kind of thing because I've done it. So it lets me empathize with the rest of the crew, and say, it's sort of like walking in their shoes, and I get to feel that out. And now that I've done that, and I know I don't want to do that again, I can then use what I know and my resources to help everyone else, which is what a good director should do. Yes. So I do think that if you want to direct, definitely grab a camera and shoot something.
Yeah.
Try and act. I took acting classes in college, so it's like I kind of know. Like,
have you acted in anything?
No. Well, I've been in a few student films and stuff, but like nothing that I did or anything. Right. Right. But then, yeah, I've been acting in college, was like improv classes. So it's just like being in front of the class and like having to like make shit up on the spot, which is hard, hard and nerve wracking. And I don't like it.
Yeah. I remember taking like directing actors, which kind of talks about it's teaching you directing, but this, my professor's like way was to learn like to be an actor too, and like try that first.
Yeah.
And God damn, man, that shit's hard.
Yeah. Oh, I will say this. I did in my class, I guess an upperclassman came in and like observed us. I don't know why. He was just sitting there with like a notebook or something, and he was like watching us and like,
he's like, Karl Fernandez?
Yeah. Oh. He was just sitting
Who's this kid?
He went to the teacher. He like they had like a conversation outside. Then they came back in, and the kid took a seat. And then like we just went on with our class, and then after class he came up to me and he asked me if I wanted to be in, I guess he was taking like a directing class or something for plays. So he asked me if I wanted to be in like a skit.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
There we go.
So I guess he was scouting.
Ew.
He was scouting, and
Karl
then he
got scouting. Yeah,
and then I ended up being in the thing, which was pretty cool. Yeah. So that was fun.
That's dope.
Yeah, I don't mind. You know, I don't mind acting, you know.
If like, anyone wants to.
Yeah, but that would all I wanted. That's all I'd want to do. Yeah. I wouldn't want to do anything else.
I feel you.
But no, it's fun, and it's good because then I did that. I did that class before I even met Dave. So it was, wait, did I? I think I met Dave. Yeah, I think I took that class before I met Dave. So like before I even like knew any of the actors at school, like I was doing that class. And so when it came to like directing him and stuff, I kind of understood his struggle of like what he had to get done. So I was like, empathy. It's all about empathy.
That was huge. Even learning. Yeah. I think I learned that through Dave as well for actors. Cause like before I did not really, I knew acting was very difficult and it takes a lot more than just, I'm going to be a fucking fireman.
Right. Like recite some lines and you know,
and I think definitely there's people out there that do that.
I know a lot of people
and are like, and are places.
I know a lot of people like that. Yeah.
Which is kind of tough, but I feel like obviously those maybe performances aren't as, you know, worthwhile to watch and you don't remember them as much, but, I think I learned that through Dave and like knowing him about how, I don't know, just how important that empathy is, you know, for each role, except for, I don't know why, I feel like a lot of people start at like PAs, like traditionally, but like, I don't know why everyone's an asshole to PAs.
It's because they get the coffee orders wrong.
Yeah. But, I think with that, like, I don't know, I feel like it's just a better way to, I guess, understand a crew. And I think that's why for this shoot and previous shoots before that is how people get so close together.
Yeah.
And breeds like a good team.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, you can always tell who wants to be there and who doesn't. Yes. And like, you know, if you tell someone to do something or like they should do it this way instead, it's because, and it's not because like, you know, I'm superior and I, you know, know more. It's more like, hey, I've kind of been in your shoes before. Yeah. This is what I did the last time and it worked out for me. So maybe you could try this instead, you know, it's just helping each other, you know?
Got you.
Yeah.
Does people keep asking you like, where is the shit? What's this? What's happening?
I know.
Does that like pressure you at all?
Yes. no. Listen. I made it clear from the very beginning that I was gonna do the post process basically myself.
Yes.
Like 90%, 95% of it. So Dave understood right away. The only thing is that he wanted to submit to a festival, and their late deadline.
Montclair. Right?
Yeah, we submitted to Montclair, and we're gonna find out later in the month, later in March. What the result is, but like he was like, is there a way we can get like a cut done?
Yeah.
And I was like, son of a bitch, Dave.
Didn't you get something in though?
Yeah, we sent like a rough cut. I mean, it's trash. No, I'm kidding. But I mean, it wasn't the final product, you know what I mean? But which is fine, because most festivals allow you to do that. You know, you have to resubmit the movie when it's done anyway.
Gotcha.
Certain formats and stuff. So I didn't have a problem. It was more of just like, I told him I wanted the thing completely done by the beginning of March, which we are actually on schedule. We are practically done. You know what I mean? I just need to do some things with the audio still. Yeah. And my brother's finishing up a bit of the music. But other than that, I just got to do a final export, and that's basically it. Having a few computer issues right now. It was funny. I told Dave on the last Thursday.
Film's gone.
You told you about that?
Yeah.
I deleted the whole thing, man. We got to reshoot the whole thing. It's things with my computer. I built my own computer and stuff. It's just some annoying things.
That's the worst when you... Because I built mine, my first computer I built. And I'm like, yeah, dude, I fucking built this shit. It's crazy. Yeah. And then you go to use it and it's broken.
Yeah.
Just blue screening. I'm like, all right.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fun. It happens. This is what happens every time.
Well, what was happening was because me and Jordan, I had to give Jordan the project file and he had to work on it on his computer at his house, and he bounced it back to me.
Weird.
So there's that whole exiting and then coming back in, and I made sure that we use the same version of Premiere and make sure all the software is the same and whatever.
I think also Premiere sometimes it's just so stupid.
I'm having some issues with my video card drivers. It sucks because I was rendering out his copy because I wanted to watch it on my TV, and I was trying to do a render, and it took almost 2 hours, and it was at the last thing, and then I get an error saying error compiling movie.
Yeah.
Some bad frame at minute 12.
Yeah.
I'm like, son of a bitch. You know what I mean?
Does your Premiere honestly, any Adobe thing for me, sometimes it just crash.
Yeah,
like
the crashing, absolutely. Dude, God. I'll do nothing, then I'll get the spinny wheel.
Oh.
And then I go just to, say, you not know what responding.
Happens? I go to export and it just crashes.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, I don't know. I feel like if I'm paying this much for this shit, come on.
I know, dude.
Shouldn't
I know.
At least feel
I know.
Sometimes, 2 weeks ago, my Photoshop just wasn't opening. And I tried getting in contact with it, and they're just gotta wait for the next older one or
you gotta downgrade, or you gotta wait till we release the hot fix coming out later this month. It's like, dude,
fuck that, man.
I mean, you got the whole suite.
Yes.
I only have Premiere.
Boy,
so I'm only paying
gotcha.
The price of that, so okay. I guess it's not too bad for my end, but either way, it's funny because it always happens at the end of the project. Mm. I had absolutely no issues bringing the footage in, editing the footage, cutting the whole movie together. I had no issues whatsoever. It's only at the last stages, right before the final export, that it's just I can't export it. And so I got a couple things I'm going to try later tonight.
I got that autosave on every second.
Dude, me too. I have that.
I don't care.
What was it? I think it was the second week into the thing. I had maybe the first two acts done, basically. Yes. And I was working on that last, the last arc of the movie, you know what I mean? And I didn't save, and it crashed. And I didn't realize how far, how long I was working on it that I didn't save. And I had to start, I got so mad, dude. I quit. I didn't work on it for the rest of the day. It crashed. I got my coffee in the morning. I got up at 7:30. Yeah. I started turning things on at 8:30. I was editing until about 10:30, 11. Then it crashed. And I'm just I'm done for the day. We're going to do this again at another time because I'm not doing this. I'm not recutting everything I just did. So
starting this fucking podcast, dude, happened every fucking episode. It's just what crashed. And I'm like, fuck. And I don't know why. I wouldn't do the... the autosave for some reason, or I would do it and I wouldn't save it for the next one. I'm like, what the fuck? And going back for an hour, and then going back, because I made editing this a lot easier for me.
Yeah,
I kind of set up my template and I just plug shit in, right?
Yeah.
And but back then I was doing every frame, and then I was using this camera, so the clips were split into 10 minute shit, and I do all this crap.
Yeah,
and it's so stupid.
Mm-hmm.
But now I don't know, it's good.
Yeah, it's all about the workflow.
Get your shit together.
Yeah, no, right? Get the workflow. Up the workflow. You know what you're doing. But the I did cut a teaser. So when I texted Dave, I did text Dave and I told him I would have a teaser that night. Again, I just couldn't export anything. And I think it has to do with the fact because he edited it, Jordan colored it on his computer. You know, he has a different computer. So I think it has to do with the media cache files. So I emptied my media cache and I ended up deleting the render, the video previews. and I have to re-render the whole thing. The only problem is it takes like forever with all the effects and stuff.
Yeah.
And like, you know, we both have very powerful computers. It's just like, you know, when you add coloring and stuff,
it takes
music, and it's just a lot of things that to throw at the computer at once. And like, even that, like, it's a short teaser. I should be able to get it out like soon, hopefully.
That'd be crazy. How's it? How do you feel about it?
Good. It's quick. Yeah. I guess one thing I can go rant about is me and Jordan feel the same way. It's like we hate trailers. Mm. We saw 1917 the other week, and there was this trailer for this new Elizabeth Moss movie. I don't know, something about a ghost or something. I don't know. It's like a horror, whatever. Yeah. It looked good. Like the first like 15 seconds were like, okay, cool. But then that's all they should have shown.
Yeah.
Most, you know, I think it's a rule in Hollywood. It's 2.5 minutes is like the standard trailer length. Yeah. You learn, dude, there's no point in watching movies anymore, man. Yeah. Like me and Jordan looked at each other at the end of the trailer and we're just like, we know the whole movie now. Yeah. Like she literally walked you through like at least a part of each chapter. And I'm just like, well, I don't give a shit about this anymore, man. Like, why would I do that? So the trailer, like all the teasers that I ever made, I did this for the Rose Garden. I did it for like all the other things that we did. This thing's like 35 seconds long. It's only a couple shots. And I include like one or two pieces of dialogue and put no context to it and like shuffle the shots around. Just to
that's
show.
Good. That's good though, you know what I mean? Just for like social media shit.
That's what I'm saying. Like we're going to put it on Instagram. We're going to say the movie's basically done. It's coming out soon. But like, we're not going to show you like the movie in a short form, like, you know, especially with a short. I mean, like, so a feature is like what, 90 minutes. You do a 2.5 minute trailer usually, right?
Yeah.
Our movie is 16 minutes. Mm. Like, we'll do the math. True. Like, I should only show you like 5 seconds. Yeah. You know what I mean?
But I feel trailers kind of only work for like some action shit.
Yeah.
It's like, put your shit fucking explode everything.
Exactly. Marvel, Michael Bay. You know, that's fine. That's fine. There is an art to making trailers.
Yeah.
It's very specific and like the way things
especially
are cut.
Like horror ones.
Yeah, exactly. And like, you know, the way you score a trailer and like things like that. Mm. Like, it, you know, trailers can be good, but I feel like just most of them
stop knocking because people are going to lose jobs. Trailers are great.
Trailers are awesome. I love them. Do more, please.
This is like the trailer guy's like, oh, fuck.
He's like, oh, no, man, not again. I mean, and then, so we saw 1917. We saw like a bunch of trailers and like there were some that were like really good. There's that movie with Ben Affleck, but he's like a basketball coach. I don't know if you saw the commercials for that. It's called The Way Back.
Oh,
yeah, it looks okay. You know, I'm not a basketball. I don't give a shit about high school basketball. But it looks like a good story. He's like an alcoholic.
It's funny the two kids that don't care about basketball are on the fucking podcast right now.
I know, right?
Every guest and Dave just that's it.
Oh, I'm sure.
That's it, dude. That's it.
Oh, I wish he was here. We could talk about it. Be like, I don't give a fuck about this movie, but it's Ben Affleck
so
and he's drinking and he's being an asshole, but he's like, he loves his kids, man. And like, he's trying to do good and like turn his life around. Look good, you know, but like, I'm like, but again, you show so much of the movie.
It's
you're
tough.
Showing all the dramatic points
that's
and like
tough.
He's like falling downstairs and shit. Yeah. I'm like, no.
I feel like it's better if you just show like a clip, like
that's
a scene or something.
I did see the one for Jordan Peele or something. He had, I don't know, I saw some trailer. It was like, he did it where it was like 30 seconds and it was just music.
Uh-huh.
It was in the thing and it said like coming soon. That, I was like, that's a teaser.
It's just simple, right?
I don't know anything about I want to watch the teaser or trailer and not know anything about it, but be engaged enough to want to go see it. That's what it should do. It shouldn't lay out everything about the movie. It should just hook you in a little bit, whether through the visuals, the music, the tone, the, you know, how the story's going to pace out.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You know, just like if it's an eerie fucking movie, you know.
I wonder if it'd be even better to just like completely not take anything from the film and just like shoot something separately.
Yeah,
it'd definitely take a lot more work, but maybe it would be a more effective approach.
I did for the teaser. I did extend a few shots that aren't like actually in the cut of the film.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh,
like people. Yeah, that's a technique. People do that all the time. Yeah, like little things. There's pieces of dialogue, not in my trailer, but like in I know there's some famous trailers out there where there's like, you should look it up at some point. It's like it's like things that you were pretty sure they said like in the movie, but they actually never said.
Really?
Yeah, there's like a lot of things like that. Yeah, where it's like, oh man, we're like, why do I feel like that came from like that movie, but like it wasn't even in the movie.
It's like some Bernstein Bears shit.
Yeah, dude. Oh, those were my shit, dude. They were my shit. I had all the books, bro. My favorite.
But was it Bernstein or Bernstein?
Bernstein? Bernstein?
Which one?
I called it Stein.
Which one was it for you though?
Bernstein.
Wasn't it like B-E-R-N or B-E-R-E-N?
I thought it was B-E-R-E-N. Baron. I thought it was Baron.
Really? I thought it was Burn. Like burnt?
I think that might be right. So when I found out, I was like, oh man, this fucked me up.
Yeah, that was the worst.
Yeah.
What's the last movie you saw?
In theaters was 1917.
Oh.
And I was...
How was 1917? Wait, you guys just saw that?
We saw it last week, I think.
Oh, really?
But it was my second time seeing it. I saw it one time before that, but I'm like, Jordan, I mean...
Fucking amazing.
You're a DP, man. You have,
yeah.
If it's one movie you have to see in the theater, like, it was a good movie. I really liked the movie. Is it the best war movie? No.
Yeah,
you know,
for sure.
It's a good movie, but I think it's one of those movies sort of like Birdman or like The Revenant. Like, you know, you have to kind of just see it on the big screen to really appreciate it for what it is, because it is a visual treat. That's really most what it is. And the production design and all that stuff. You saw it, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Awesome. It was
the behind the scenes is so worth the watch too.
Exactly.
My
God. Yeah. All the stuff at the end with the church and stuff, the nighttime stuff, insane. So I had to drag Jordan and be like, you gotta go.
He definitely needs that.
And especially because, you know, he saw it after the Oscars when Deakins won for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. His second Oscar ever. So.
Oh, really?
He only won once for Blade Runner 2049 last year.
Damn.
And now he won again this year for this. But he's been nominated. He's been nominated like 14 times in his career. He's never won.
That's
so
insane, man.
Yeah. So. Props to him. So I said, Jordan, you have to see Deakins like master one shot work on like the big screen. Mm. You have to. Mm. And he loved it. So it was great. So
awesome.
Yeah.
I guess in the past couple films, I actually watched an animated film like 2 or 3 days ago. I Lost My Body.
I heard about that.
Dude,
it's I think I started like 10 minutes of that movie. It's on Netflix, right?
Yeah. It's such an interesting like concept for like, especially like this kid, it's a French movie.
Yeah.
It's fully animated and this kid like loses his hand.
Yes.
And it's about the story of like his hand trying to find his way back to the kid.
It was so deep for me that I had to turn it off. I'm like, I'm not in the right mind headspace for
that. It was
that,
really fucking good. Yeah. I was surprised, man. So if you guys want to check that out, I Lost My Body.
I saw something this kind of flew under the radar. It was The Art of Self-Defense on Hulu. It's Jesse Eisenberg.
I haven't heard that.
Oh, dude, it's fucking hilarious.
Really?
It's funny. It's like a black comedy. It's very like, you know, like dark humor, but
I was gonna say we can watch some trailers and shit too if you want.
Oh yeah. Art of Self-Defense. I thought it was hilarious. And I'd love to make a movie like this at some point. Hope you can hear that breakdown in the back.
Let's go. Peace.
Karate's a way of communicating. Ask me a question.
What are your plans for the weekend?
I'm going to do some grocery shopping and rent a film to watch in the comfort of my home. Did that answer your question?
Oh, God.
I want you to tell me why you're here.
I'm afraid. I'm afraid of the dark. I'm afraid of other men. I want to be what intimidates me.
You came to the right place.
I'm taking my first class today.
Your new white belt?
Is that the first belt color?
White is before color. You haven't earned color yet.
Today's lesson, to kick with your fists and punch with your feet.
That makes perfect sense.
Good. There's a mental component as well. Everything should be as masculine as possible. You may want to start on those reports. That pile is getting awfully high.
I won't be petting you anymore. This is for your own good.
What's your favorite style of music?
Adult contemporary.
No, it should be metal. You're a blade and I'm sharpening you.
I see a little of myself in you.
Is that you, Sassy? Ah! Why are you filming this?
This isn't a safe place, Casey. Hey!
I know you're confused about what's happening. You have to trust me.
You should have never started taking karate.
You can't be weak anymore.
I'm interested in buying a gun. I need something that can fit into my hand.
Sounds like you're after a handgun.
I challenge you to a fight to the death in unarmed combat.
This is your belt.
It is yours. It is sacred. There'll be a $15 charge to replace a lost belt.
God damn.
It's funny, dude. It's it's funny because I actually took like Taekwondo.
Really? Yeah, yeah, me too. Yeah. Me too as a kid.
So it's funny because it pokes fun at the whole like strip mall karate thing. But it's also like there's a lot of jokes that like they say it, and like if you don't listen, it like kind of goes over your head. Uh-huh. But it's funny, man. It's funny, and it's like it kind of becomes like a thriller like halfway through. Yeah, like you got that vibe from the trailer, but it's fucking hilarious, dude.
Is that too much of you for you for a trailer?
A little bit.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, a little bit.
Fuck.
That's I think because I saw the movie, I can sort of, I guess, judge this trailer. I don't think, you know, you watch it and you still kind of don't really know what's going on. They did leave a lot of things out, so which is good. So you kind of just get this, you kind of more or less just get Jesse Eisenberg as often as you can. And then, you know, kind of show
it's
him.
It's not that bad.
No.
It's not that bad.
I don't think, it wasn't revealing as much as some other trailers
that's
do.
That's funny though.
Yeah.
Have you ever done like comedy shit? I feel like that's a tough thing, man.
Dude, it's tough, man. Comedy is way, it's hard, man. Yeah. It's hard.
Would you ever want to like write something?
Comedy? Yeah. And I feel like, you know, my line of comedy is something like that. So like that I can't do like the Seth Rogen. Like, I can't do the punch, like the, just the gut bursting laugh, like hangover shit. Like I can't, I don't know. I don't think I can do that, but I can do something more like, I'd like to write something like this where it's more, just like in the dialogue and it's like, it, like really just like jokes that like people don't say, you know what I mean? Like just really, it's very taboo. Like a lot of stuff they talk about in this movie is very taboo, like masculinity. And
did you say this was the Jordan Peele?
No.
Who was this? I wonder who.
This came out already. It's already out on Hulu. It was a trailer I saw in for 1917.
Oh, and
yeah, it was like a little teaser thing. Yeah. But, yeah, dude, comedy's hard. I think.
Yeah, especially writing, because you gotta be writing like a comedian then, with like jokes and shit.
You have to, you know, when you do a drama, it's so easy because life is tragedy.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like everyone relates to tragedy at some point, but like everyone has a different taste in comedy. So like what makes people laugh is gonna be a lot more different than what makes people cry on an emotional level. So there's nothing worse than like having to like write a joke. Like I would hate to like, let's say I directed like a comedy or whatever, and like we're in the theater and like we're all watching it, and like my favorite joke comes on and no one laughs, dude. I would want to die right then and there. I would quit. Yeah. I would just be like, yo, this is the best part.
Yeah.
The joke comes and like you just hear like, like just one person coughing in the audience, and then there's like that sustained silence of just, and you're just like, oh shit,
fuck, that was terrible.
Like it's not funny.
I guess that's why there's a lot of, there's definitely more like drama and serious like short films, I guess.
Yeah.
You don't really find a lot of short comedic films.
No, I've seen a couple that were pretty good.
Too is for like the characters.
It's a thing, man. Like, you know, like when comedy, like, you know, if someone's trying to be funny, like it has to either be like relatable to what they're experiencing, like, or, yeah, I don't know. I think it has to do more. It's harder to relate to someone and try and laugh with them or at them than it is to sort of like feel sorry for them.
Yeah.
You know, so when you do a drama and like someone like dies or something, you're like, oh my God. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Someone says a joke, like, you know, you're either supposed to laugh or you don't. And like, you can't control that.
Yeah. So, that's so bad.
Yeah. And I've seen some pretty bad like comedy movies, like at film festivals and stuff. Like where it's just like we're in the audience and like the director's there and he's expecting to laugh and I'm just sitting there like, oh shit, no one's laughing. I think we were supposed to laugh at that part, guys. Oh no.
The worst is feeling like bad for like another person, I think.
Yeah.
When they're showing something.
It's tough, man. I'll say this right now in front of everyone. I am not the biggest fan of like going to film festivals. I know it sounds a little weird considering I make films and I do go to festivals. But like whenever we go, I don't know. I kind of like just not. I don't know. I'm not a big. I can't sit in that theater from like the start at like 10 a.m. all the way to like 6 p.m. and watch everything that's coming through. You know what I mean? I've found a lot of good gems. You know, there's definitely a lot of things, but then there's a lot of stuff that you could tell. Like you were saying earlier, with actors who kind of just do it just to do it. You know, whatever.
Yes.
You can tell.
Uh-huh.
A lot of those movies get shown, and
yeah,
you know, and it's just. And then there's one movie that I saw. I think I was with Dave. It was some festival we went to, and it was just like just the weirdest thing, dude. Just like weird, gory. Just like like poop buckets and stuff, oh. like prisoners in like the basement with like a dungeon thing. I'm like, what the fuck, Dave, did you bring me to, bro? And it's a feature, and I gotta sit through this shit.
It's a feature, dude.
10 minutes in, I'm like, Dave, I wanna leave, bro. I'm going to have a cigarette. I don't have cigarettes, but I'm gonna find one.
Yeah. Well, hopefully we have a festival run for, I'll meet you there.
Yeah,
for
sure, yeah. For I know sure. Dave, if he does listen to this while he's in LA, I need the list. He owes me a list of festivals.
Oh, we'll get we'll get him on that. I need him for
tech specs. I need to know what kind of exports they need and stuff. So yeah. So get on it, Dave.
Dude, that's another thing. I had breakfast with my parents today, and they were talking. I taught to teach them about, like, this is another thing where people like that aren't in film and stuff like that, with like exporting and like different code, like all these different like resolutions.
Yeah.
Shit for TV, because I have my brother is doing shout out Sebastian and shout out Eric. They're doing a kind of like a video job in Japan. They both live there, and it's for like TV, and they're doing it on like retro gaming and stuff.
Oh, cool.
And they did like some exports, and they were sending it to like over to us, and like my family was like, oh shit, cool, like let's watch this stuff. And stuff for TV is like lower quality, you know, especially like cable and shit like that.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember from my one junior internship, we were like sending out like DVDs still, and it's fuck, man, it's just how it is.
Well, most broadcasts doesn't go more than 720 still at this point.
Yeah, like, so like just explaining to that is so like weird, like how not a lot of people know.
Yeah, it's weird. And then I think the one that I can fault most people for is the smooth motion. Turn it off, people. Yeah. Turn it off on your TV sets, please, for the love of God, turn it off. I think LG and Panasonic.
Wait, that's actually like a thing.
You don't know smooth motion?
I don't think so.
You know, you've definitely, you go to any like any store or Best Buy, the smooth motion where it's just like super fluid. Oh. Like something, they call it the soap opera effect.
Oh, that's like an actual thing that you could do.
Yeah, well, it's like basically turned on by standard.
Oh,
by TV manufacturers. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know it's an actual thing you can toggle.
You got to turn. Turn it off, man. Shit. Turn it off, dude.
Yeah, it looks terrible.
Movies are not. Dude,
it looks terrible.
I can't stand. Like, I go to like a friend's house or whatever, and they have like a giant, really nice, big screen TV, like 65-inch screen, and we're putting on like, you know, something epic. You know what I mean? Something like Avatar or something, or not really Avatar because that was filmed in. Yeah, like let's say we're gonna watch The Irishman, you know, and like if I see that smooth motion on, bro, I'm gonna leave. I'm taking the popcorn and I'm leaving, bro, because
it's visibly terrible.
The smooth motion, like, I understand why they do it.
Yeah.
Like, I understand because most of what you're advertising in the store, like, you know, whatever.
It's like a jaguar walking through, like, the forest. Yeah.
And that stuff is already usually shot at, like, really high frame rates, like at, like, 60p or whatever. But film is 24.
Yeah.
It's supposed to have that stuttering effect. It's supposed to not look crystal clear like that. It's meant that way on purpose. And cinematographers like Jordan and myself, we spend a lot of time crafting the way the image is supposed to look, only for manufacturers to completely ruin it by adding, they add like phantom frames, so there's like extra frames that aren't even really there.
Really?
But it's like meant to like smooth out the judder, but it ends up being like too smooth, and like it's just, it's not good.
Damn,
it looks like you're watching football. It looks like you're watching the Days of Our Lives for everything. And like, it's terrible. And I wouldn't mind it if it was an option on TV, on most TV sets, but it has to be like turned off by default.
Yeah.
Like, if you want it on, then you can go and turn it on, go through the mess of like going through the menu and turning it on and off. But like this, like the fact that it's standard and basically any TV you get now and like you take it out of the box, turn it on, it's going to have the smooth motion on. And most people just don't know.
Yeah.
And most people just don't care to like, you know, turn it
off. That's crazy.
Yeah. So I was at a friend's house a couple months ago, and we were all drinking, and they were like, oh, let's watch The Rose Garden. We haven't seen the movie. And I'm like, okay, great. We're like, we'll fire it up, you know, whatever. And then, like, we turn this TV on, and, like, it's smooth motion. So I'm like, I spent about, like, 15 minutes. We had to find the remote because we didn't have the remote. So everyone's, like, getting tired. Yeah. We're sitting there, like, drinking. It was like, yo, I'm like, no. Like, we're not starting it until I get this fucking smooth motion turned off, all right? So I'm, like, going through the menu, and I'm like, all right, let's turn the TV off, turn it back on. Let's see if that worked. You know what I mean? And we got it to work. Finally, but like
spend more time like finding how to do it.
Yeah, I think more than the whole movie. Yeah, I was very adamant about that, and I'm still very adamant about it. But LG and Panasonic and a bunch of other TV manufacturers actually met up with like Martin Scorsese and Chris Nolan. I think those are the people they met up with. They're gonna do a filmmaker mode on newer TVs.
Oh, there we go.
Where you just click that one button and it'll turn everything to 24p. It'll take all that smooth motion off and add some extra like HDR effects or something for like the movies and stuff.
Shit.
So.
That's cool.
yeah, hopefully that becomes standard real soon. Because
fuck yeah,
I've been wanting to rant about this for a while, so thank you for having me on.
Yeah,
because I hate it. I hate it.
It's weird. I was talking about it. Yeah, that's perfect. Another thing I watched. So with Parasite and Bong Joon-ho and getting all, I decided to go and like watch some of his older films. Mm-hmm. I mean, Okja, I feel like is a more
I haven't
recent.
Seen anything.
Really?
I haven't seen anything.
I watched Snowpiercer.
How was that?
Dude, this was came out in like 2016.
Yeah.
I feel like we should watch the trailer for this. Yeah, I was so like, what the fuck? Like I would never guess like that he made this.
Right.
Is there something right here? Chris Evans is the lead. Mm-hmm. And it's like this like almost like Blade Runner-esque like apocalyptic thing. Like apocalypse in the world. There's like a huge snowstorm that wipes everything out in the world. And like the last thing surviving is this train.
Mm.
And it's going, it's this train that it goes around the world. They built like it's set in the future and like obviously like post-apocalyptic. And this big disaster made it so like this train thing is the only thing alive. And like they built a train to go around the world through every continent. And it's like, just like they don't know when they're going to die. And like, there's like a hierarchy. There's like rich, poor, and like middle class and like lower and just like homeless people. But it's at the end of the train and these people decide to like rebel and go to the front.
Ah, so it's like an allegory crazy. For like, oh yeah. He does that a lot, right? That's like kind of what Parasite is. It's sort of like a class.
Yeah,
he does
true,
things,
actually.
A lot of things in class. And
so what's the trailer?
Yeah, I have not seen Parasite yet.
You haven't?
No, dude. I haven't seen any
what?
Of his movies. I know. I'm a terrible filmmaker. I spend more time making
crazy.
Films than I do watching them. That's
let's watch this really quick. This is I was just so surprised at this. You might want to watch this thing. It's on Netflix.
Yeah, I've seen it on Netflix.
This chaos. 1,000 people in an iron box. 18 years I've hated a train. 18 years I've waited for this moment. This is your world. The train saved humanity.
The engine lasts forever. The population must always be kept in balance.
I said sit down.
Passengers, eternal order flows from the sacred engine. We must occupy our preordained.
It's all a train.
Yeah.
I belong to the front. You belong to the tail. Know your place. Keep your place.
Those bastards in the front think they own us.
We'll be different when we get there.
What you say?
We take the engine. And we control the world.
When is the time?
Soon.
This is disorder.
We're going to the front. Open the gate.
We know you well, Mr. Curtis. We've been watching you. Precisely 74% of you shall die.
Everybody back!
I'm not a leader.
You're ready, our leader.
This is your destiny.
Yeah, solid.
Damn, boy.
Yeah. That's crazy.
Yeah, wow, that really showed, like, everything about the movie. And that sucks. It literally showed every scene from beginning, middle, to
okay,
all the way to end.
Because I didn't see it, and I thought the same thing.
Holy
I would've,
shit, man.
I would have cut it off right when he said, like, we're going to the front.
Yeah.
Like, that, and, like, boom.
Oh, my gosh.
Snowpiercer. Like,
I feel like it kind of hypes you up, though, to see it.
No, it does. I think, again, it has to do with the score, and it has to do with just the way they cut things. They, like, you know, it's always towards the end of the trailer they start making the shots shorter.
Yes.
They start cutting and making it more montage-y, you know, to sort of, you know, keep your attention and also still draw you in.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I haven't seen it. I mean, I'm still going to probably watch it.
Honestly, very good watch.
Yeah.
Just for, like, if you want to see something that's just, like, I don't know, just very action, like, packed and, like...
Yeah.
It's just a good thing.
Yeah.
Just nice.
Was Parasite, would you say Parasite's better?
Parasite, I think, is a lot better. Yeah. This was like, I don't know why, like, Chris Evans, I feel like, is like the same role in every movie.
Yeah, it's like the superhero type
yeah,
guy.
It's like,
just like the masculine
and like,
machismo. Yeah,
I think definitely the acting's very, like, I don't know. I guess it's tough because, like, the world is so, you know, just, like, weird and, like,
yeah.
unrealistic,
right?
In a way,
obviously, because yeah.
But it's definitely still a cool thing to watch.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Parasite definitely is like performance, like directing, like edit, like everything is amazing.
Yeah,
it's like 5 out of 5, I think, for in everything.
Yeah, me. Oh, it's good, man. I gotta check.
You gotta get on it.
Yeah, fuck. I mean, yeah. I haven't. I'm slacking.
No, I think it's still in theaters though.
Yeah, I think there's a few showings at the Montclair Theater. Yeah, they're only down to like 2.
Yeah,
it's like in the evening.
Dude, the Montclair Theater's dope.
Claridge, shout out Montclair. Yeah. Claridge.
Like to show like all those films place, and everything. Dude. Like they show the Oscar shorts and shit for a while.
Yeah, they do that every year.
Yeah,
they do that
it's
every
dope.
Year.
It's dope.
Yeah, there's a lot of movies that I can go see there that I like wouldn't see anywhere else.
Yeah. Really.
It's like you'd have to go to like Lincoln Center and like Manhattan to go see those movies. But they do a good job. They do a good job. Yeah.
Well, hey man, we're in an hour. I think we did good.
Hey man, yeah.
I think we did great.
I think it wasn't bad.
I thought it was gonna be a little bit of a train wreck, but I feel like we held our own.
I didn't know what we were gonna talk about when
me
started.
Either.
So
I had a couple things, but that's every time I write down so much and I think it's so much. But I'm like, that's not so much.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy.
So, but God, fuck, what am I going to do?
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, this is good, dude. Thanks for coming in.
Yeah, of course, man. And, you know, if you want to replace Dave, I'm always, you know, available.
Hell yeah.
You know.
Boom. We're going to make this a thing. Dave, next week, sorry. Because you left us.
Yeah, bro.
I don't know what you're doing, dude. I don't know.
You're in the sunshine of
partying,
the party right now. Yeah.
You know,
hanging out with some celebrities and trying to shoot a new movie out there. And I get it. You know, it's cool.
I see.
Leave us here in the cold.
Shoot one little short with us. All right.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah. Shoot 6 with me and then just leave.
Just kidding, Dave. We love you. Damn, that's episode 58 of the podcast. Karl Fernandez in the building. Catch him on Instagram, Karl Ferns, Color Science, Spotify. Listen to the album. Boom. Episode 58 of the podcast. Find the podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Anchor.fm, YouTube with the video, www.yourherepodcast.co. We cannot afford the M. I'm Mike. I'm signing out. Thank you, guys.
Later.